Hurricane Dorian decimated parts of the Bahamas last week and then churned its way north, leaving a trail of destruction. Such major weather events seem more common these days, and many people assume they are symptomatic of climate change. Are they? Let's ask climatologist Michael Mann. He is the Distinguished Professor of Atmospheric Science and Director of the Earth System Science Center at Penn State University, and he joins us via Skype from State College, Pennsylvania. Professor Mann, good to have you on our airwaves again. How are you tonight?
I'm good, and it's great to be back with you. Thanks.
Terrific. I'm going to begin by quoting something that you co-authored in The Guardian recently, and it goes like this. The Bahamas, for those who live there, is simply a place to call home. For many Americans, it's a dream vacation spot, but Hurricane Dorian turned that dream into a nightmare. And the worst part is, this is only the beginning. Because unless we confront the climate crisis, warming will turn more and more of our fantastic landscapes, cities we call paradise, and other dream destinations into nightmarish hellscapes. Let's start by asking you what makes Dorian, in your view, more destructive than previous hurricanes.
Well, it's in a class of hurricanes that we've seen recently that have reached the upper levels of intensity, the highest intensities that we've seen. In this case, I believe the Dorian tied for the most powerful hurricane measured in terms of the maximum sustained winds, 185 miles per hour. The most intense hurricane seen that far east in the Atlantic, and to make landfall, which it did on Bahamas with truly destructive impacts. These storms are, simply put, being made more intense, stronger by warmer oceans that have been warmed by the increase in greenhouse gases in the atmosphere caused by fossil fuel burning. So there is a direct connection. We can connect the dots between human-caused climate change and the extra warmth that allows these hurricanes to reach higher levels of intensity. In fact, there is an empirical relationship that is now well established that for the strongest storms, these Cat 4 and Cat 5 monster storms, there is an increase in the maximum winds of about 7% for each degree Celsius warming. And we've warmed the global oceans about a degree Celsius, the tropical North Atlantic even a little bit more than that. For each degree Celsius, 7% increase in the maximum sustained winds. And here's the problem. The destructive potential of a storm is actually proportional to the third power of the wind speed. So when you increase those wind speeds by 7%, it translates to a 23% increase in destructive potential. And we saw that increased destructive potential play out as the storm made landfall and decimated the Bahamas.
Now, it's interesting to me that you're that categorical about it, because I know in the past, for example, when Al Gore has been asked, can we say that this hurricane happened because of climate change? He's always been careful to say, well, you can never really say that. But you're saying that now. So what's different?
Yeah, so we have to be very careful. Both of those statements are actually correct, believe it or not, which is to say that we can't say that Dorian wouldn't have formed, that that hurricane wouldn't have happened in the absence of human-caused climate change. That is up to the vagaries of weather, sort of the random chaotic nature of our atmosphere. But what we can say is that once that storm formed, once it did exist, it had the potential to reach higher intensity because of the warmer oceans. It carried with it more moisture because of the warmer oceans, and that's another simple physical relationship. You warm the ocean surface by a degree Celsius, you increase the water vapor content by, again, about 7%. And that means there's the potential for much larger amounts of rainfall. And we're seeing that with these storms. And then finally, the third ingredient here, and this is one where we've only really begun to understand the underlying science. It's really at the forefront of the science. But the fact that these storms now appear to be slowing down and stalling when they make landfall, with catastrophic effect. We saw that with Harvey and the 3 or 4 feet of water that fell on Houston over a period of a few days. When Hurricane Florence made landfall and there was extreme flooding in the Carolinas, and now with Dorian, when it made landfall and it literally just got stuck in place, it sat over the Bahamas, subjecting them to these decimating winds and storm surges that together pretty much leveled the island. That is all symptomatic of the warming of the planet. And so while we can't say that climate change causes any one particular storm, we can now say with a great deal of confidence that it is worsening the impacts of these storms.
And you are convinced, based on your expertise and your understanding of the way things are, that we will be seeing more of these and harsher storms and hurricanes going forward. Is that right?
Yeah, you know, too often we hear the term new normal. Is this a new normal? And I don't like that term because a new normal sounds like, okay, we've arrived in this new place and we just have to figure out how to adapt to it. But it's worse than that. It's an ever-shifting baseline. As we continue to warm those oceans, these storms will become more powerful. They will hold more water vapor within them that can be turned into larger amounts of rainfall. And so as these, you know, impacts all come together, we expect climate change to continue to create more and more devastating storms if we continue on this path. Now, the good news is we don't have to continue on this path. We can act on climate change, but we have to do it now.
Hmm. Now, just forgive me for getting parochial here, but here in the capital city of the province of Ontario, we haven't had a deadly hurricane in, well, since the mid-1950s, Hurricane Hazel. Is that to suggest that we are going to have to wake up because they are coming?
Yeah, in fact, there was a study that was published in the premier journal Nature just a few years ago that demonstrated another impact that climate change is having. It's actually causing these storms to track northward in the northern hemisphere from where they used to track. In other words, we might actually see a decrease in the landfalling storms that strike Florida and Georgia and the Carolinas at the expense of more storms making it up the East Coast into the mid-Atlantic states, into New York, into New England, and indeed into parts of Canada. There is an expectation that we may see more storms come your way, unfortunately.
Okay, I'm not going to pretend that you're going to like this quote, but I'm going to read it to you anyway and get you to react to it. Here's Roger Pelkey, professor at the University of Colorado, writing in Forbes magazine, and he writes, "A final confusion is an assumption that climate change means that everything is getting worse. As Hurricane Dorian was bearing down on the Bahamas, Catherine Hayhoe of Texas Tech argued that the right question to ask of hurricanes and climate change is, how much worse did climate change make it? Again, we can expect that on balance, climate change will intensify some extreme weather now and in the future, but there is no expectation that every single hurricane will be made worse. That is just hyperbole," says Roger Pelkey. What's your response to that?
Yeah, well, you know, Catherine Hayhoe is a leading climate scientist trained in the underlying physical science. She understands these systems very well and the impact that climate change is having on them. Roger Pelkey Jr. is a political scientist who mostly talks about policy. I believe he's now a specialist in sports writing. In my view, Roger Pelkey Jr. is somewhat out of his depth when he starts weighing into the science, the underlying physical science of climate change and how it's impacting the hurricanes. And what Catherine said is absolutely true. You know, we have warmed, again, the planet by a degree Celsius. That means that there is more energy available for every single storm that forms. There's more moisture in the atmosphere with every storm that forms. And in fact, there are now scientific analyses that are done, sometimes even as these storms are playing out, what's known as detection and attribution, where climate scientists can do an experiment where they take their climate models and they run them both with pre-industrial levels of CO2 before we started to impact the climate and modern levels of CO2. And they see how often particular events happen in those two cases. And if there is a substantial enough increase in the frequency of that event in the model that has been subject to human-caused climate change, then they are able to attribute that event. They can say that that event, you know, was made two or three or four times more likely by human-caused climate change. In other words, there is essentially a causal linkage. It's statistical in nature, but it's a causal linkage. And this is now done with pretty much every one of these storms. And there's already a study out that shows that Dorian was in fact made more destructive by climate change.
I'm going to go off the question sheet just for a second here, because I can't help but notice that on the left of our screen and just behind your right ear is a book you authored with the words "the hockey stick" and "climate wars" in the title. Yeah. And for Canadians, anything having to do with hockey sticks does raise eyebrows and increase curiosity. What's the reference there?
Yeah, so the hockey stick is this curve that my co-authors and I published 2 decades ago that demonstrates the rapid warming of the past century and how unprecedented it is as far back as we were able to go at that time, 1,000 years. And it became, if you want to mix metaphors, a lightning rod, an iconic graph in the context of the climate debate. And I found myself in the center of that very fractious debate because of this iconic graph that we published. And so that book, The Hockey Stick and the Climate Wars, is about my experiences at the center of the fractious debate over climate change, in substantial part because of this graph that we published 2 decades ago. But I have noticed that that metaphor translates much better in Canada than it does in the U.S., and I do attribute that to your expertise and interest in that sport.
Okay, thank you for that. Tell me this, based on what you've seen with Dorian and, of course, many of the more recent hurricanes that we have seen subsequently, are we getting any better to adapting to the havoc that they are wreaking?
Yeah, I mean, so there are sort of 2 competing effects here. Climate change is making these storms worse. And that's a result of, you know, continued burning of fossil fuels and the warming of the planet. But mitigating that to some extent are the fairly impressive advances we are seeing on the science side, on the forecasting side. Our ability to forecast the tracks that these storms are likely to take and even the intensities that they're likely to reach, which has always been difficult. It's always been a challenge for the models. But what we're doing now is we're taking the forecasting models. These are weather models, but we can combine real-time observations to help keep them on the course of reality. And with the satellite data and other measurements and aircraft reconnaissance, airplanes literally flying through these storms to collect essential data, we can take all that information, put them into the models, and there is now a clear increase in the skillfulness of the forecasts. We're doing a much better job forecasting where that storm will be and what intensity it's likely to be 3 or 4 days out. Now, here's the problem. The warming of the oceans is leading to faster intensification of these storms. You may have even heard the term rapid intensification. We've heard that a lot recently with these storms. And what that means is that a storm that basically goes from barely, say, being a tropical cyclone to being a Cat 2 hurricane in the course of just hours. And the warmer those oceans are, the more rapidly those storms can intensify and the less lead time we have. Suddenly, they're a Cat 4 or Cat 5 monster, and we haven't taken the preparations we need to. So that is an aggravating effect. Even as the science gets better, these storms are becoming more and more unruly and less predictable, and that's a real challenge for all of us.
You know, President Trump said something the other day, and I think most people dismissed it out of hand as being ridiculous, but you're an expert, so I want to ask you directly. He said maybe we should think about dropping a nuclear weapon in the middle of a hurricane, and that would somehow dissipate it more quickly, and it would wreak less havoc. Can you tell us whether there's any intelligent science behind that idea?
Yeah, well, the havoc would be if we started doing that. So it turns out back in the early 1960s, fairly early on in sort of the nuclear era, there were some experts within the weather service that actually speculated about that. And there's some reason to believe that if you put a large enough amount of energy into these storms, you might be able to disrupt them. Here's the thing, a Cat 5 storm expends more energy in 20 minutes than a 10 megaton nuclear bomb. And so we would literally have to set off one of these nuclear bomb blasts every 20 minutes to keep up with the natural intensification of these storms. It's a drop in the bucket. It wouldn't work. What it would do, of course, is infuse the oceans with radiation. And where do these storms go? They travel from east to west. they make landfall along the U.S. East Coast and in the Caribbean, we would be subjecting people potentially to large amounts of dangerous radiation, nuclear radiation, were we to do that. And of course, we would be radiating the oceans and negatively impacting sea life and fish populations. It's just a bad idea no matter how you look at it, but we've come to expect some ideas that aren't really that sound from this particular president.
That was very diplomatically put, Professor Mann. And with that, we thank you for coming on TVO again tonight and joining us from Penn State University in State College, Pennsylvania. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Always a pleasure.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario. CPA Ontario is a regulator, an educator, a thought leader, and an advocate. We protect the public. We advance our profession. We guide our CPAs. We are CPA Ontario. And by viewers like you. Thank you.